Fluorescein is a pretty interesting molecule with quite a wide variety of uses because it's quite fluorescent but has a very low toxicity. In particular, this low toxicity allows it to be used for everyday things as well as in the medical field for diagnostics. I actually find it pretty interesting that the toxicity is low enough that it can be injected into people to help map the vascular system and diagnose diseases. I should note, though, that just because the toxicity is low, it doesn't mean that people don't have bad reactions to it. Another common use for the fluorescein is actually in highlighter markers. I won't be doing an extraction from highlighter markers because there's already another YouTube channel that has done this, and I'll provide the link below. All of these uses of fluorescein are pretty interesting, but I'm going to be totally honest and say that I want to make it just so I can play with it. So with that being said, let's get started. I start out by adding 2 grams of phthalic anhydride to a small round bottom flask. And then on top of this, I add 3 grams of resorcinol. And then to this, I add 5 drops of concentrated sulfuric acid. Ideally, the chemicals would have been mixed up before adding the acid, but oh well. It's then lowered into an oil bath and heated to 190 to 200 degrees Celsius. As the oil heats up and the chemicals start to react, you'll notice that a red color starts to form. This is actually the first bit of fluorescein being made. Slowly as the oil gets hotter and more will dissolve and the solution will get redder and redder until it eventually becomes nearly black. I had a stir bar at the bottom and eventually it became liquefied enough that I was actually able to stir it. So we want to heat it at this temperature of around 200 degrees Celsius for at least 30 minutes. It's important not to heat it up too much because the product can decompose. Above I've included the overall reaction that's occurring between the phthalic anhydride and the resorcinol. So as you can see, one molecule of phthalic anhydride will react with 2 molecules of resorcinol. The mechanism behind this reaction is pretty complicated and there's 3 distinct steps that occur. Without going into too much detail, the phthalic anhydride undergoes a Friedel-Crafts reaction twice with each molecule of resorcinol. These 2 Friedel-Crafts reactions result in the production of 1 water molecule, but they also create an intermediate molecule that can undergo a Fischer esterification with itself. So it does just that, and in doing so, it forms the final fluorescein molecule and also expels 1 water molecule. In the scheme, I've color-coded everything so you can see where things end up. All of the hydrogens in the waters come from resorcinol, but in each water, 1 oxygen will come from the resorcinol and the other will come from the phthalic anhydride. The sulfuric acid that is used is a catalyst, and it will catalyze both the Friedel-Crafts reactions and the Fischer esterification. If you would like to know more about the mechanism, I've included a good link below in the description. After the 30 minutes is up, it's removed from the oil bath and allowed to cool to room temperature. At this point, you can do 2 things. If you don't want to isolate the fluorescein, you can simply dissolve this crude product in some sodium hydroxide solution. This would give you a nice stock solution that you can start playing with immediately. This is what is done in most of the videos I've seen online, but I actually wanted to isolate the fluorescein itself. And to do this, we're going to need to do a little bit of a workup. It's taken inside and a stir bar is added, and you can see the crude product has now solidified. I then added about 15 milliliters of acetone to dissolve the fluorescein. Fluorescein is very soluble in acetone, but we do have a hard block on the bottom, so it still takes a little while to fully dissolve. Slowly, as more fluorescein dissolves into the acetone, it should get darker and darker red. Eventually, when it doesn't seem like much more is dissolving, the acetone is decanted into a beaker. The process is then repeated by adding more acetone until everything in the flask has fully dissolved. In the end, I used a total of about 50 milliliters of acetone, but the exact quantity really doesn't matter. Even when there's very little fluorescein left in the flask, it might be dyed yellow, and it's kind of a waste of acetone to try to fully remove it. So here's the beaker, which looks like it has a bit over 50 milliliters of acetone. The heat is then turned up and the acetone is removed. The use of the acetone is really nothing more than to just transfer it to a larger container. By doing this, the surface area is increased and it makes for the next step where we dissolve it in ether go much faster. In theory though, you can skip this step, it just might take a lot longer to dissolve in the ether. When the acetone's all gone, we're left with a syrupy mix on the bottom that slowly solidifies as it cools down. Once it's fully cooled down, we're left with a nice red glass on the bottom of the beaker. To the cool glassy mixture, I added about 20 milliliters of diethyl ether and a few milliliters of distilled water. The fluorescein is actually not soluble in water, but the addition of it greatly increases the rate that it's dissolved into the ether. Another stir bar is placed into the beaker because the old one is kind of stuck in the mixture. A watch glass is then also placed on top because ether evaporates pretty quickly. At some points when it didn't seem like a lot of the fluorescein was dissolving, adding more water seemed to be more beneficial than adding more ether. And to speed things up a little more, I added a further 20 milliliters of diethyl ether followed by a little bit of water again. After about 10 minutes, a lot of it was dissolved except for some goo on the bottom. The diethyl ether and the water was then transferred to a separatory funnel. And the dissolving step was repeated by adding another 40 milliliters of diethyl ether to the beaker, followed by again several mils of water. You'll notice that this time, the ether seems to be a lot less concentrated with fluorescein than before. And if you look at the bottom, there's still a lot of that black stuff. Anyway, the diethyl ether and the water was again transferred to a separatory funnel. More diethyl ether is added, but you'll notice that there's still quite a bit of that black stuff at the bottom. I found this stuff was stubborn and it really wouldn't go into the ether layer unless I added a bunch of water. Keep adding water until it fully dissolves into the ether layer. In this step, I added a lot more water than I did in the previous one, and you can see the ether has taken up a lot more fluorescein. And after just a few minutes of stirring, it seemed like everything was taken up into the ether. So again, just like before, it was added to the other extractions in the separatory funnel. And then, with a small amount of ether and water, a final washing was done of the beaker. And then for the final time, this was added to the separatory funnel as well. Once all the extracts were together, I mixed them around thoroughly. Before proceeding on, I drained away the lower water layer that was left over from the extraction steps. And now to our fully loaded separatory funnel with our product, I added 50 milliliters of water. This washing step serves mostly to wash out sulfuric acid and leftover resorcinol. So as we always do with the separatory funnel, we cap, shake, and vent, and then we put it back on the stand for the layers to separate. Once the layers have separated, we can discard our lower water layer. The washing step is repeated, but this time I use 50 milliliters of saturated salt solution. You'll notice that before adding it, the top ether layer is a little cloudy. However, after the capping, shaking, and venting, you can see it's cleared up a lot. So now the bottom layer, which is mostly water, is drained away into a beaker. The upper ether layer is poured into an Erlenmeyer flask, and it's dried using molecular sieves. This is just to pull out any of the water that might remain. I also could have used another compatible drying agent like sodium sulfate, but I just like molecular sieves. After letting it dry for several minutes, it's directly gravity filtered into a round bottom flask. I then set up a little simple distillation to remove and recover my ether. Near the end of the distillation, it looks kind of like red paint. It was actually really hard to dry, and at this point it didn't really seem like any more ether was coming off. To solidify it, I actually had to pull a small vacuum on it while heating. Eventually, we were left with this very dark red crust. However, it was still a little bit damp despite the vacuum and the heating, so I took it out and put it in an oven. Be careful if you do this though, because there will still be some phthalic anhydride left over, which might sublimate. After the oven, I was left with about 3 grams of nice dry fluorescein. To test it out, I then prepared a sodium hydroxide solution. Once it had fully dissolved, I added a little bit of fluorescein to it. You might notice the sodium hydroxide solution is a little bit green before I add it. This is because the spatula I used to put in the sodium hydroxide was contaminated with a little bit of fluorescein. Anyway, I then turn on the stirring to fully dissolve the fluorescein, and you can see the solution quickly turns to a dark red. However, you might notice at the top it's actually a little bit green. From the stock solution of fluorescein, it can then dropwise be added to a beaker of water. And I do this under UV light for added effect. At this point, you might find it interesting how the solution of the fluorescein is red, but when it's dropped into the water, it's green. You also might remember me pointing out like 20 seconds ago that the top of the fluorescein solution was green. This is a good example that highlights the major difference between transmitted light and reflected light. A small amount of light is reflected at the surface and we see it as green, but the light that keeps going and makes it through the solution comes out as red. This is because if the concentration is high enough, the fluorescein will quench its own fluorescence. So now we'll mix it up a little so we have a nice solution of glowing water. It's actually kind of fun to play with, and it's kind of cool to pour glowing liquid. However, you'll probably notice that the glow seems much less on the smaller beaker. This is pretty much just because it's further away from the black light, and you can see that when we slide it closer, it gets much more intense. Interestingly enough, it glows quite well during the day as well, and you don't really need a black light to see it. It might just be the lights that I use, but during the day it's actually still pretty cool to see. The black light really does provide better contrast, but if you don't have access to one, I think this is still cool enough. In this shot, the effect is highlighted even more, where you can see it's a red liquid in the pipette, but the moment it goes into the water, it turns green. In the pipette, the concentration is high enough for it to quench its own fluorescence, but when it's dropped into the water, the concentration is decreased and we can see the nice green fluorescence. So in the end, we're left with about 3 grams of fluorescein contaminated with a little bit of phthalic acid or phthalic anhydride. Remember that if you're just looking for a quick and easy way to get the fluorescein solution, you don't have to go through all of the purification steps. However, I just did it because I found it more interesting and I wanted the fluorescein powder. Anyway, that's it for fluorescein, but in the future I do plan to make a video where I go into more depth on fluorescence in general.